How many of you know that this is, or may know or may not know, this is a moed this weekend? What a moed is a Hebrew word moed means to a time appointed by God to meet with his people. And he set these moeds up throughout time the Hebrew calendar. Sometime we, the church, have got away from the place of doing what God said to do and begin to take up pagan things to do. When God said to keep the feast or keep a moed, he meant that. It doesn't matter if you're Jew or Gentile. God said that he didn't come to abolish law, but through him the law might be fulfilled through Christ Jesus. So we're sitting on the last day of the Feast of Purim. And this is a very significant year of Purim because it is a Jubilee year. If you don't know, you might not know what that is. Let me explain that to you, because when you get to know what a Jubilee year is, you will get excited and you begin to dance. You'll begin to shout. A Jubilee year is 50 years. God said every 50 years that everything that was stolen, everything that you lent or owed to somebody, everything that you owed a debt to, everything that was stolen from you, it had to be returned. No questions asked. Debt cancellation, debts were canceled totally. And the thing was, in the year of Jubilee, it didn't matter if it was your fault or not. Everything was canceled. Come on, somebody. You might have messed up on your finances. You might have messed up in your life. But God says this is the true year of Jubilee, set forth in God's calendar, in which all things are released. Debt cancellation. Hallelujah. Slaves were no longer slaves anymore. Their debt was paid off. They were released, debt free. You could go. There was nothing against you in the court of law anymore. Wiped out. So this, what does it have to do with Purim? This is a awesome day of Purim. This is awesome year of Purim. It's a moed, a time when God appointed time to meet, to remember something significant, and to celebrate something significant that happened to God's people. Hallelujah. There was a young lady who was a Jew. Some over 2,500 years ago. In the kingdom of King Xerxes. She hid her nationality. She hid her nationality because she was Jewish. And Xerxes was of the Media Persian Empire at the time, where Turkey and all that is today. And in that time, she was brought into the king's harem. To be chosen of all the different women being prepared for the king to choose to be the queen. And some people say, oh, it's so romantic and stuff. No, it wasn't about romance. It was about sacrifice. It's about what are you going to do to give up? It's a hard thing. But here was this young lady in the place of the royal court, and she was chosen over all the other ladies. And the woman I'm talking about is Esther. She was just a lonely, homely girl. But God had favor on her because of her tenacity to give up everything. See, we think of the king when we think of the story, oh, Queen Esther, that's so great. It is a great story of God's miraculous power, how he saved the Jewish nation. Without Queen Esther and her tenacity to go into the king's chamber to do what she had to do, the Jewish nation would be wiped out. But it's not only about Esther, it was about her uncle Mordecai and an evil man named Haman that plots plans against the righteousness of God. I'm talking about people. And in this time, she was just going to go about her day. She was picked to be queen, and she was just going to go about her daily activities. And she would be spared above all everybody else because she was the king's bride, king's wife, the queen. But all the rest of her people, the Jewish people, would be wiped off the face of the earth by Haman, who plotted against to have the king sign a decree unknowingly that would have the Jewish people wiped out, killed. That's the assignment of the enemy, to kill, steal, and destroy. That's what Yeshua, Jesus, says in the Word. But he says, I have come to give you life and life more abundantly. You see, the thing is, in the time, and Mordecai, the uncle of this young queen, talked to her, said, you know what, if you don't do something, God's giving you favor for such a time as this. In fact, the scripture says this, and he puts it this way, who knows that you were born into the kingdom for such a time as this? Who knows if you were born into the kingdom for such a time as this? And beloved, I'm here to tell you the same thing. This is a Kairos moment of time in which we're living, to take the initiative to to do the same. For I hear the Lord saying, who knows if you were born into the kingdom for such a time as this? And my heart is telling me that answer is yes. We were born into the kingdom for such a time as this. To seize the day, seize the opportunity that God has opened up a window of heaven for us to move in. Destiny. But are you willing to take a chance? Esther took a chance. Esther said, you know, I don't know about this, Mordecai, but I'm going to do it. I'm calling a fast. Me and those who take care of me, we're going to fast 3 days. I'm calling you to call a nationwide fast, a empire-wide fast for 3 days, fasting and prayer for 3 days. And after that 3 days, she said, I am going to go into the king's chamber. And I'm going to present to him the plight of my people. For you see, in that day and that time, you couldn't go into the king's chambers at all unless he summoned you. You couldn't knock on his door. I don't care if you were the queen or not. And she would have knocked on his door of his bedroom or of his chambers, and he didn't want her to be there. He could have had her beheaded. And she says, If I live. If I die, I die. Nevertheless, I am going to go to the king.
I'm home.
It's talking about sacrifice. What are you going to sacrifice? What are you going to sacrifice to see the king? Not only the king, but the King of Kings. What are you going to sacrifice to do what he wants you to do? What's God telling you? For the New Testament Revelation chapter 10, it says they overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and the word of the testimony. People stop right there. And the third part of that verse is the crucial part of this end time move. This whole end time, the last great thrust of your and the greatness of your destiny depends upon the third portion of this verse. And it says, and they love not their life to the death. I heard it said, somebody said, I love to give credit where credit is due, but I've heard it said that if you have nothing worth dying for, you have nothing worth living for. If you have nothing worth dying for, you have nothing worth living for. And you live bored. You live like a bored Christian. And beloved, a bored Christian has a big bullseye painting on their chest or heart. Has a big bullseye painting on their chest. Waiting for the devil saying, come and get me, devil. I'm open and I'm gullible.
Let all the earth rejoice. Let all the earth rejoice.
But we found out in the story that she was bold enough, she fasted and prayed, she went into the king's chamber, knocked on his door, and he opened the servants opened the door, and he held a scepter out to her, and she was accepted to come near him. God intervened on her behalf. And we see throughout the story of Esther, and the plans of the enemy that Haman tried to build the gallows and the pole to be the spear Mordecai through. We see the plans of the enemy was sprung on himself. See, it's not just about hearing the word. It's not just about beautiful coming to church and hear a beautiful sound. There's people that will go into church all over, hear a sound that tickles their ears. In fact, Paul warned Timothy that be obedient to read read and know and follow sound doctrine, because there's people coming. He said there will be ones coming who are deceived by the enemy. And they'll get their own preachers, and they'll go to preachers and that will fancy their every whim that's in their life. Oh, we like you, preacher. We like you, pastor. We like you, evangelist. We like you because you don't tell us about our homosexuality. You don't preach against our lustful lifestyles that we go whore around. Is that all right to say that in church? To whore around on the week, on every day of the week. And being whoring around doesn't mean going into bed and sleeping. It means whoring around and fancying with men and women. Get their own way.
And time is in your hands, beginning and the end.
Preacher, don't, I love you, just don't preach against that. Just don't preach against the sexual immorality. Don't preach against drugs. Don't preach to me about alcohol. You know, I like to sip on those wine coolers on a Saturday night and have about 12 dozen of them. You remember what God brought out a few weeks ago about the gray areas? Gray areas are shaded areas. And the shade is not the light, and it's actually darkness. We're called to be children of the light. We're called to walk in the light. To be a city on a hill that cannot be hid. Is calling for total commitment, total commitment, total commitment. Are there things in your life that you're saying, God, I just want to hang on to? The Word of God says, seek ye first the kingdom of God and all of its righteousness. Then everything else will be added to you. Some people are going to everything else and asking God for everything else, but they're not doing what the Bible prescribes and being obedient. You'll never get to eat of the good of the land if you're not obedient to what the Word of God says. If you're seeking for everything else first, you ain't going to get it. It's going to fall straight on its face. You gotta seek the kingdom of God. You gotta seek Jesus first. If you want something, be in love with Jesus first and foremost. What are you willing to give up? What are things in your life that you have to get rid of? Are there some things on your tablets? Are there some things on your cell phone? Are there some things on your computer you need to get rid of? I'm not talking about if you have pornography, you better get rid of that. Because you're better than that. You're better than that. You're better than that, beloved. I'm talking about things that steal your time, rob your time away from God. If your tablet offends you, get rid of it. Or get rid of the applications that you spend a lot of time on. Just allow this time right now. I believe God's speaking to some people here and over the internet. This is a deep time. Why? Because we have all kinds of hell breaking loose out there in this nation and in the nations, but God has a better plan. Spent the last 3 days up at a prayer conference called POTUS Shield. You say POTUS, President of the United States, but we prayed just a little bit about that. There's a lot of stuff that in the backgrounds that God intervened. It is intervening. And a great awakening is about to happen. And the last third wave, I believe, the last and final wave of the glory of God is going to be released upon this earth soon. Because this is a Kairos. What you're talking about, Pastor? Kairos moment. There's a difference in the Bible that talks about two different terminologies of time. There's Chronos in the Greek, which is your calendar year, your time clock, which we had to set our clocks forward here. Lost some sleep, but praise God anyway. We're all here. That's a Chronos moment. But a Kairos moment is a specific moment of time in which God breaks the heavens open. Where all heaven breaks open. Kairos moment. See, the thing about the Kairos and Chronos is that we're oblivious because we stand inside of time. God doesn't. God stands outside of time. He's eternal. He's an infinite being. And that infinite God can become a finite being when he came to earth in the form of a man named Jesus and suffered at the hands of mankind. Mankind's sin, our sin. The Romans didn't put them there. The Jewish people didn't put them there. All of our sin put him on that cross. And he laid down his life. He had no sin at all. He was beaten 39 times. Did you know, beloved, in the modern medical journal of science and medicine, they say that there's 39 major diseases. 39 major diseases. And he's taken 39 lashes on his back, that by his stripes we are made whole. Made whole. See, there's a cure to cancer. His name is Jesus. His name is Yeshua Rofa. Jesus, the healer. Or Adonai Rofa. The Lord, our healer. God Almighty, our healer. Who takes away our pain. Who takes away all of our sickness and disease. And he placed it on the cross, along with our sin, our shame, all the sins of all of our lives, he taken it upon him. And beloved, when you see yourself in that light, that's the miracle. That's the glory of God in itself. The fullness of his glory is Jesus hanging on that cross. It's not the goosebumps, yet that's considered the glory of God. It's not speaking in tongues, that's part of it. But the greatest definition of the glory of God is when he died on the cross and he rose again on the third day. See, God's the God of miracles in this day and age. There's just so much I can't go into because of confidentiality of what happened over the weekend up in that conference. But I tell you this much, there's a nation going to awake And I will tell you this, that one thing is that there will be a petition in this house. I'm going to urge you to sign it, that you believe that this nation, the decree will go to the White House and the Congress and to the government this fall, this upcoming next year. They're asking for at least 10 million votes. I mean, 10 million signatures on this, pleading with our president, pleading with the Congress, the government, declaring that this is the nation one of one God, one God, one nation under God, indivisible, once again. So there's some exciting things going to happen. But the thing is, Esther did her part. Esther did her part. What are we going to do? What are you going to do? You say, I'm just me. I'm a nobody. See, Esther was a nobody. She was just brought into the crowd of the women, which were hundreds of women. You talking about the bachelorette or bachelor? Brought in and pampered and bathed and all kinds of lavished and fed the best meats and everything else. And man, she was a nobody. Just a little Jewish woman. Hey, brought into the king's chambers, the king's harem courts. Say, hey, you go over there. You look like you're of age that the king might want to marry you. Come on. Like, what? Given everything. And the thing is, at the end, she had the keys of the kingdom of King Xerxes. Anything she said went, because she had the king's favor. She was the king's favorite. I want to say to you that you're the king of kings' favorite. Not because of who you are, not because of what you've done, because in your own right, in your own style, man, our own style, our own righteousness is filthy rags. Man, it's his righteousness, his doing. Everything is about him. So just allow God just a little bit longer here. Allow God to keep you along today. Continue to allow God to search your hearts right now. What are you holding on to? Let the question of Mordecai to Esther be the same as you. What if you? What are you going to do? There's a plight of a nation. There's a plight of your friends at risk. Spoke a word quite a while ago called "The Destiny of Many Waits for You." The destiny of many waits for you. See, God will, if you continue to wait, God will raise up somebody else, yes, at a time, but it'll just pass you by, and it'll make you bitter. So why don't you just be obedient to lay down your life and say yes. Yes, I lay down my life. Do you know what the Bible says? That we have no rights. Our life is not our own. We sit there and squab. I say we because, yes, we all do that. That's why we need to be in check all the time. say, no, I will not be like this. I'm going to do what you said for me to do. I'm going to be willing and obedient to lay down my life. And I'm not talking about being stupid and go over to, you know, without the leading of the Holy Spirit, that is. You know, you're just saying, get on a plane and go over to Syria. I say, hey, Jesus is Lord. Your head gets slid off and you're outside the will of God. You're wondering, hey, what's going on here? God, I'm standing before you. But God wants you to go in his strength and his power and his wisdom of how to operate and your destiny that he's called you to. See, Esther did not just fast for any reason. She fasted to get a plan. And God gave her a plan. And she did the plan. She went in and we see what happened. It was kind of a kind of awesome plan. That even Haman, at the time when she was telling the king giving a little bit clues of what she wanted, she told him, and Haman had to dress up Mordecai and put him on a great stallion and robes and everything else and a signet ring of the king and parade him through town. The person that God, that Haman, rather the enemy, had a bad, meant bad for, God turned it around for good. But the thing is, God gave Esther a plan, and she stuck and she followed that plan. See, that's another thing with your destiny, to lay down your life and then pray and get a plan of action to be mobilized into what God has told you to do. See, many people want to go out and say, God tells you, I want you to go out and be an evangelist. I want you to go evangelize. And many people just go out there and evangelize without getting a plan of how to do that. And they go door to door and knock at the door and door to door and they get rejected and then they quit. Because that was not God's plan. Or maybe it wasn't his timing yet. So like Esther, she fasted, she prayed, she got the plan from heaven. She heard the voice of the Lord and not the voice of CNN, not the voice of Fox News, not the voice of CBS or ABC or CBS or ABCDEFGHIJKLMNOP. See, if you're getting your news from the media, you're getting your news from the wrong place. I don't care if it's Fox News or CNN or whatever else. I dare you to go to your prayer closet and get the initiative of heaven and begin to hear his plan. Then you could turn on the news and watch it come to pass. Oh, three days comes past, and you say, you're looking at the headlines on the news, saying, man, I just prayed about that a few days ago. Does that stuff happen? Yes, it does. And God wants us to operate in that area because we have authority and dominion and influences over all aspects of society. Because he wants his kingdom to come and his will to be done on earth as it is in heaven. But he wants our hearts. He wants us to lay our life down and say, man, I'm willing to go all the way, God. Say, Pastor, why do you feel safe to go to, you know, the last time I went to Israel is when they went to war. They're blowing up stuff in Lebanon and back and forth. I was in the will of God. I was right smack dab in the center of his will. And when you're in that center of his will, being obedient, you know what? You're safe. And even if you did die, if I did die, if you die, guess what? Ha ha! You're before the face of the Lord. Ha ha. many people are afraid to die. That's the thing, is fear. Maybe that's one of the things you need to allow God to search your heart this morning, or maybe he has already searched that area of your heart and says, you're a man, you're a woman full of fear. God, come and help my unbelief. Get rid of the fear, huh? How about depression? Doesn't belong in the kingdom. Only joy. Fear doesn't belong in the kingdom, only love. For God has not given you a spirit of fear, but power, love, and a sound mind. The ability to make rational, sound decisions that line up with the Word of God. Fear your finances. Well, I can't give to anything because, you know what? If I give, I won't have enough. I won't have enough. I won't have enough. There was one time I was asked when I worked in the secular workforce in Pittsburgh, big company. Don't ever ask me to go to a board meeting or something like that, because I'm going to tell the truth. They asked me, of all things, what do you think about about bonuses and stuff, about giving stuff and everything like that, about giving. I just told them what the Word of God said. I told them what God told me. He said, you know what? If your company closes his fist like this and holds his money tight like that, you won't have no money left and you go under. But if you open your hands open and are generous, guess what? You'll be blessed. Unfortunately, I left that company. I moved to another place, another company. And unfortunately, that company went under. It's no longer in business. See, if you don't listen to what the Word of God is saying, guess what? It's not good for you. God wants us to be obedient, to hear the voice of the Lord, and not just hold on to the things that are emotionally, I don't want to go there, God, I don't like it. But God says, you need it to be free. You need to be free. Lay it down, let it go, lay it at the feet of Jesus. You'll find out. You'll find out that you'll be so much lighter all about. Just to let it go. Because Jesus already taken everything upon the cross. We no longer need to carry it, but to lay our lives down, to take up. And we'll see miracle after miracle after miracle after miracle. We'll get so many, there'll be so many miracles where we'll be like, oh God, slow down. I just can't take on this many miracles right now. I just don't know. I just blessing at the, but the thing is, you got to be a person to lay your life down like Esther did. To be willing to say, if I die, I die. But nevertheless, I am going to go into the King. I'm going to do whatever God you tell me to do. No matter how hard it is, because God, you will equip me to do what you told me to do. You will empower me to do it. And I will be abundant in every facet of my life, doing what you want me to do. Putting a plan of action just to our lip service. Oh, did we just go there? Oh, being doers of the word and not hearers only. So this is what I'm going to do this morning. Just over this next few moments. Just over this next few moments. Just allow God to check your hearts. And this is something between you and the Lord. Just yourself. Allow God just to search your heart right now as He's been searching your hearts this morning. And just in your own way, just give it over to God. Say, God, I just give it over to You. In your own way, surrender it. In your own way, die to yourself. Die to yourself and be alive in Christ. And in your own way, say, I'm not just, and if you don't feel it in your heart that you could do it, don't. Because you're making a real pledge to the Lord today. I just, too many times that people feel the urge of the Holy Spirit in services, and then they just get, I got to do this, and they just do it, and they don't mean it. And people go out living the same old way as they did. This is for the committed. Are you willing to be committed enough today to say, enough is enough, change is here? Then there might be some things that you might need to do. You might need to erase some people's phone numbers off your phone. You might need to take some apps off your phone. You might just need to reprogram your tablet or your computer. You might have to reset your schedule of time. Say, no, I can't go do this at this time anymore. Because this time is reserved for the Lord. It's between you and the Lord this morning. So this time, just take this time. Continue to take this time between you and the Lord. We could put some music on, but you know what? That's just music. It's sound. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Now, Heavenly Father, I ask You, come seal it. Come seal it. Come seal it, Holy Spirit. Those who are making decisions this morning, those who are making commitments, new commitments this morning, those who are saying, if I die, I die, but I'm going to follow You. I'm going to do what You told me to tell me to do. I'm going to set You first in my life. I'm going to die to self this morning so that You will live through me. Seal that, Lord. Seal that, Holy Spirit, this morning. Seal that by Your great love. By Your great grace and mercy, Lord. Seal it with Your fire, Lord God, this morning. And let that fire burn deep. Sealing it, sealing it, sealing it in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. And let the miraculous come. Let the miracles come. Let the abundance come as the obedience flows from every life and heart and every decision made this morning. To consecrate their lives as Queen Esther did. She laid it all down on the line and found favor, found abundance because she was lived a life of obedience, not a selfish life, but a humbled life of obedience. Now, throughout this week, God, continue what you're doing. Continue what you're doing. Continue to solidify. Continue the burn with your fire. Continue to mold and shape the commitments that were made. Come and challenge the commitments that were made, Lord, in your precious holy name. Now, Lord, I pray a blessing on everyone here. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and grant you his peace. Shalom. Nothing broken, nothing lacking. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen and amen. Everyone be blessed.